The next panel includes, first, Dwayne Matthews. Dwayne is the Vice President for Policy and Strategy for the Lumina Foundation for Education. The foundation has a goal to increase the percentage of Americans who hold high-quality degrees and credentials to 60% by the year 2025. Dr. Matthews served in a variety of higher education leadership roles, including a senior advisor to the president of the Education Commission of the States and also the executive director of the New Mexico Commission on Higher Education. He actually also began his career as a first grade teacher. Tim Nelson is president of Northwestern Michigan College. Tim has founded three business firms, taught small business management, entrepreneurship, and corporate finance full-time at Michigan Tech University, and also taught at Western Michigan University and Olivet College. George Ross is the president of Central Michigan University. He has also served as the president of Alcorn State University. He was an executive at Central Michigan, at Clark Atlanta University, the University of Tennessee at Chattanooga, and at Tuskegee University. And our final panelist, who will also facilitate the panel, is Jim Hackett. Jim is the president and CEO of Steelcase, a global leader in the office furniture industry. Jim's a member of the executive committee of the board of directors for the National Center for the Arts and Technology. He is a University of Michigan graduate and a member of the Business Leaders for Michigan's executive committees. Let's welcome our next panel.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's an honor to be up here talking about talent. And while it is a hot topic and current, it feels like something that's been around a long time. In fact, John Wooden, as a coach of UCLA who had innumerable championships, was asked about his coaching skills. And he said, well, the first thing you need to understand is you can't teach 7 feet. which was his way of saying that I win because I have talent. And these gentlemen are going to help me try and establish why that imperative is just so important for our future. And I arrived here after lunch, but I think if this was mentioned, it's worth repeating that we find ourselves in the age where we've moved from agricultural to the industrial age. And in that industrial age, you know, it was natural resources and physical labor and power that ultimately gave us an advantage. We're now in progress to a bigger era, and it requires human intelligence, knowledge, and collaborative skills. And we're going to talk today at length about how that actually creates great opportunity, and in turn, why it's a difficult transition for some. The change, though, is undeniable. We can't turn away from it. We can't hope that we can slow it down. The clock of history is always ticking. It always has. Competitive and advantage and prosperity will go to those states that can best prepare themselves to be ready to compete on a global basis. And in doing so, we have to recognize some things that we're going to talk about in terms of what does it take. Now, there was a survey done of manufacturing executives, some of which were inferred in the last discussion, that talent's more important than anything else the legislators might be working on in economic, trade, or tax policies. We know from an earlier discussion today that talent drives innovation, and without innovation, we don't have an engine to compete. And this is not just technological innovation, I hope comes through today, but also innovation that's about how we redesign processes and performance. We're going to talk in a minute about the types of skills that we need. And a key question or two that we want to get at is, do we have the talent today to compete and in the future to spur this innovation that allows us to compete nationally and globally? We got some great things going for us. We do have momentum. Michigan is first among all the states in terms of engineers as a percent of the workforce. We're number one. We're 18% above the national average in terms of the number of the STEM graduates. And we're among the top 20 states in the number of bachelor degrees in natural sciences and engineering. These are very thoughtful sciences. They're going to be really important. So I'd like to turn it to Duane Matthews of the Lumina Foundation, because they've set a big goal for the United States to have 50% of the population have college education by 2025. So Duane, maybe you can tell us more about that goal and where we stand today and how we compare.
Great, thanks very much. And thanks to all of you. It's a great pleasure to be here. You know, when we set this goal, we first were looking at this international data on higher education attainment. And I suspect a lot of you have seen this data. It talks about what percentage of the people in all the different countries around the world have completed some form of college, either a two-year or four-year college degree. The U.S. is right around 40%. It's a little bit less than that. About 38% of Americans have completed a college degree of some type. And what's getting a lot of attention is that a lot of countries in other parts of the world have now seeing pretty dramatic increases above that level, especially among young adults. So if you look at this data internationally, it tells a very interesting story. We began to try to understand what the story was about. It's broken down by age. So if you start by looking at the entire working adult population, 25 to 64, again, you're looking at about 40% of Americans have completed college. If you look at the oldest part of that population, the 55 to 64 age group, which I have to admit I'm right in the middle of that age group, so you know, open disclosure there, the percent of Americans who've completed college is right at 40%. If you look at people between 45 and 60 and 54, 40%. 35-year-olds, 40%. Look at 25-year-olds in the United States. How many of them do you think have completed a two-year, four-year college degree? 40%. It's been amazingly constant, remarkably constant over a long period of time. Now, so far, so good. You know, a lot of us Americans, we kind of think, well, 40% feels about right. After all, we use terms like college material. You know, certain people are college material, and other people, you know, not everybody should go to college. That's probably true. And it seems like we've kind of settled that this 40% number feels about right. Well, when you look at the data and start breaking it down, it starts to tell a very interesting story. If you look at that 55 to 64 age group, the group I'm in, that 40% level is the highest in the world. Americans between the ages of 55 and 64 today are the best educated in of that age group anywhere in the world. Of course, I'm the child of the baby boom. I'm a baby boomer. We built a community college system. We built up our four-year institutions to educate the baby boom generation. And so we had that benefit. If you look at that 40% for 25 to 34-year-olds, the United States is 14th in the world. That same number is only good enough for being 14th. South Korea today, 25 to 34-year-olds today in South Korea, 63% of them have a two-year or four-year college degree. So that's what we're up against. That's the global competition. Well, we wanted to delve into that and understand what was driving that. And of course, we've heard all about what's driving it already. It's the global shift in the world economy towards the emergence of a knowledge economy. The global competition for skills and knowledge is what's driving it. It's all about jobs. And other countries are seeing that they need to increase higher education attainment rates, not just for a small number or even a 40% number, but for the large proportion of their population. And they've pushed on beyond levels which we thought were felt about right. And they're getting much higher levels than where we have been. And that's the challenge before us, is how do we get on that same trajectory and start to increase levels? If you're interested, by the way, this data is broken down by state. So I could tell you the Michigan numbers. Michigan is at 36.4% today in higher education attainment rates, two-year or four-year college degrees. And among the young 25 to 34 population, it's about 38%. And it ranges from a high of 60%, believe it or not, in Ouachita County. You find a similar pattern where the universities are. You have very high levels of attainment. But the higher ed attainment rate in Lake County is 16%. So that gives you a sense of the enormity of the challenge that some of our communities are facing.
And from my perspective, to have us continue to understand what the imperative is, let me just talk to you about a minute what Steelcase looks for in terms of talent today. As Duane said, the essence of the challenge is to find people with critical thinking skills. Business and the nature of what it takes to compete, as we just described, has amped up. And if you wonder if that's really just business people imagining it or if in fact it's happening. There's all kinds of metrics that explain the speed of which industries are being transformed, or look at Fortune rankings of corporations and how long they last, and or the term of a CEO, for example. The speed in which things have compressed is undeniable. So critical thinking skills are important because of what one has to sort through in terms of the options that they face. Now, as I describe these other two skills, think in addition to that of a knowledge worker, we can also think of people in operational jobs needing these other two, which are social skills, the ability to collaborate, and the reason for that is simply the need for parallel processing. Problems are so complex that you're never going to have enough expertise in one brain, and so you're going to have to work through others, if not even in other parts of the world. And then third is to have actually physical skills, dexterity, hand skills. Mary Sue Coleman has talked a lot about engineered manufacturing jobs in the future that require the ability to think, but also the hands to be precise. Anything that's sub that doesn't require the thinking or you don't have to be precise, those jobs are already going to low-cost countries. So what we want to talk about now is how, given kind of that reality, that, you know, we can use education to help us make the transition. And President George Ross from Central Michigan has some insights in terms of what higher ed has to do to help us with that. George?
Thank you, Jim. Let me kind of frame this. It's about access, but it's also about success. And we've got to do both of those ends of the spectrum as students come to our campuses. Let me share some numbers with you. We're predicting the need for 1 million college educated adults between now and 2025. But the environment we're operating in right now, on an annual basis right now, we're graduating about 110,000 high school graduates out of Michigan high schools across the state. And that number's going down at a rate of about 3% a year. We're predicting a double-digit decrease in available high school graduates in the coming 10 years. So in addition to needing a million college-educated employees over the next 10 to 12 years, we're going to have less high school students to choose from. In other words, if all of them went to our 15 universities, it still wouldn't be enough. So part of the strategy has to be providing seats for qualified Michigan students, but also, frankly, looking outside of Michigan to attract students here. Access. We've talked about financial aid. Financial challenges to our families are tremendous. At Michigan universities, as we've dealt with this billion-dollar reduction in state appropriations over the last decade, we've heard about efficiencies. We've had efficiencies from computer systems to purchasing coalitions to take dollars out of the universities and make as affordable as possible tuition to our students, but it's still too much. So what we have done is made a tremendous increase in student financial aid in these recent years. Someone mentioned earlier 135% increase in financial aid over the last 3 to 4 years. But with that increase in financial aid to our students, it also requires literacy within those families to understand the financial aid challenges. Something as simple as filling out a FAFSA, simple for those who do it every day, becomes a major challenge to our families as we go forward. But I also want to talk about access from a social-cultural standpoint. It's not just a student coming to school, getting financial aid. It's really engaging those students much earlier in the process. To engage students in high school now, to convince them to come to college, in the state of Michigan, that's too late. And on our campus at Central Michigan and our sister campuses, we're engaging them not when they're prospects in the 10th and 11th grade, but when they're suspects in middle school, to get them culturally ready to accept college. Someone mentioned earlier that some of us in Michigan may not appreciate higher education and the importance of it, but unless we're talking to students when near their middle school levels to help them learn how important it is, it will be not as effective to recruit those students. Success of our students. I want us all to understand that when students come to our universities, they're not those same clogs in a wheel in a manufacturing operation. And we'll talk about throughput a steel case and what they need is important. But these are individuals. And part of our challenge coming into universities across the state of Michigan are high school students that are underprepared. And part of the challenge is getting them ready for college and university level work, getting them to understand the importance of higher education, getting them socially prepared as we deal with individuals every day to get them through the process. Financial aid is key, but getting them socially prepared is just as key.
Thank you, George. Now, the professor at Rotman in, or the dean of the business school, Roger Martin, who helped found Monitor with Michael Porter, has done an analysis with a gentleman named Richard Florida about the nature of jobs in the next decade. And Richard Florida is the gentleman who coined the phrase the creative class. So this might not surprise the people in the room, but if you look at routine labor as a percent of our workforce, you know that the line's actually been declining since 1910 in the United States. And of course, it's sped up to now. The forecast is between 2006 and 2016, the U.S. will have had 15% of its employment in what we call routine physical jobs. 15 goes to 8%. And routine service jobs goes from 43% to 50%. It actually grows in that period. And the creative class jobs are the fastest growing by far. Now, if you thought of creative class and the routine jobs as the two, we still believe that innovation is important in all three of them for us to compete. And Tim Nelson can talk about how the community colleges help fill a void for those who kind of migrate out of high school, are not going to go to college, but we need them to have an enhanced kind of background for any one of these jobs. Tim?
Well, thanks, Jim. And we heard a lot about universities, and we use that word. Community colleges are part of the higher education system in Michigan. And I think one of the issues is we need to recognize that and focus on the assets that are provided. There are 28 community colleges in the state. We serve about the same number of people, headcount, as are served into 15 universities. Nationally, that's true. 50% of the students who are in higher ed are in community colleges. And so when we look at only a segment of the system, I don't think we come up with the right business answers. We're an open access institution. So as Jim said, we have people who come to us who might not be college bound originally. However, we're finding because of our cost structure and because of our short cycle time that we are increasingly becoming first choice for people who do seek a baccalaureate degree, a master's degree, and a doctorate degree. Now, some of the things that we've done in Michigan that relate directly to serving that population include passing what's called the New Job Training Act within the state. And that's basically a TIF fund for talent development. It allows us as a community college to work with regional businesses who want to add new, well-paying jobs to their payroll, and we forward fund, either through the college's funds or through bonds, that training. The university then captures the income tax that was provided and pay that off over a period of time. Now, we do the things that you think of. We provide certificates, we provide associate degrees, we have non-credit learning that provides someone with the skills that they need within the workplace. And at the same time, we're kind of the boots on the ground. If you think of technology transfer, we're there with our local businesses, particularly in the non-urban areas. You find that it's the community college businesses come to say, okay, how do we fix this? How do we move forward? A couple of numbers, because this relates to what you had said, Dr. Ross. If you look at the pipeline, there's no way to get where we've said we want to go by dealing just with high school people. 2008, we did a study in the state that said 1.7 million working adults in Michigan could not operate effectively at the eighth grade level in one or more of the four standard areas that we count as college readiness. That was 30% of our adult workforce. Add to that in an earlier conversation, we have about 1.3 million people, adults in this state, who have some college, but no credential. So one of the things community colleges are working on is what's the credential of the future? Is it just the degree? We've seen more licenses. We've seen more industries say, you know what? That proxy that you call an associate degree or a bachelor's degree isn't a good proxy for the skill set we want. So here's a new program that we have and a new kind of, if you would, private corporate license that quite often community colleges deliver. We believe that our ultimate purpose is to provide our learners with skills, experiences, and values that will allow them to create social and economic wealth. That's different than saying our job's to give somebody a degree. So we're constantly asking that question and saying, what's the nature of the skills? And business helps us define that. What are the kinds of experiences, not necessarily what we have been doing for decades and generations? And what are those values that are going to help drive the economy and the social structure forward?
Thank you. So let me just stop for a moment and ask the members of the audience if you would take a moment and write on the cards in front of you a question or two. We'll make sure that the panel has a shot at them. And if there aren't any on their way up here, let me start with asking, George, maybe I could start with you, is how do you respond to those who say a degree isn't a ticket to success? Maybe those with liberal arts degrees, which I have one, so I'm hopeful that I have a future.
So, Jim, what did you get your degree in?
It was in liberal arts.
Liberal arts.
I majored in finance, but it was a liberal arts degree.
Well, that kind of defeats that argument, doesn't
it? Yeah, it does.
Look at the numbers. Look at the earning power of college graduates versus the earning power of high school graduates. They speak for themselves. A degree makes a difference. It makes a difference to corporations in this state by having, as you said earlier, critical thinkers. As important as the STEM subjects are, and they're critically important, it's central across all 15 universities, not just the research universities, but all 15 universities. We've increased enrollments in the STEM areas, in those areas of research and innovation. But liberal arts, I would argue, are equally as important. I did not know that the CEO of Steelcase was a liberal arts major, but he demonstrates that. Because at the end of the day, and we mentioned earlier, the requirements and the technology that all these wonderful innovators will be putting in front of us, in front of corporations, is changing so rapidly. So we want a workforce that can think, that can write, that can communicate, that can socialize and deal with. I tell my students at Central all the time, you're not competing with the students at Grand Valley and Western. You're competing with students in Beijing and Paris, that international audience out there. So these degrees are important in teaching our students how to learn, to teach your employees how to learn, how to innovate, how to critically think. You can't do that without the appropriate and proper training at the university level. High school is a stepping stone. There's an argument right now that even at the bachelor's level as we move forward, it may not be enough in order to keep up. When we listened to Dwayne talk about where we stand in the world against other countries, I think we're 16 on your list. It's scary almost. So I would argue any that a college university education, as I look around this room, and I imagine 95, 6, 7, 8, 9% of the people in this room who are successful people through learning at college and university level, including community college, how to think, how to innovate, how to change, because we don't even know at this point what the jobs will be 5 or 10 years from now. So.
We talk about this at Steelcase a lot. The Moore's Law effect means that the telephone you're using today will cost 1/10 of what it does today in 5 years and be 10 times more powerful, and that a Maasai warrior in Africa has more computing power in his hand today than the President of the United States did 15 years ago. So it's a big challenge in terms of, you know, matching our future with what we're going to need. So, Dwayne, we got a question from the audience. Is how do we match the right 18-year-old with the right degree program? Mm. And the underlying this, the nuance is the amount of remediation for freshmen and the low completion rate make this person think that we aren't doing a good job helping them make a good decision.
Well, we're not. Let's answer that question right away. We're not doing a very good job of that. And so how could we do it better? First thing is that we need to make sure that students who come out of high school are in fact prepared for success in college. Now, we all want them to be successful in college. Nobody wants to give students remedial education, and nobody wants to take it. So why is there so much? And a lot of it is that students, you know, we use phrases like college ready, we bandy them about, we use them all the time, and we assume that everybody understands exactly what that means. But what does college ready really mean? Especially if you're a first generation student, a kid whose parents or whose older brothers and sisters did not go to college, and they don't have anybody necessarily that they can ask, what's college readiness really mean? When you've taken the courses that are required, when you passed high school and you passed the state assessment and you go to college and you find out that you're tested into remedial education, whose fault is that? So the first thing is to make sure that these standards are actually aligned, that high school graduation standards and not college admission standards, that's not actually what matters. What matters is the cut score on the placement exam for remedial education. That's what matters. Is the student coming out of high school ready to test out of remedial education and go straight into credit-bearing courses? That can be done. It's not easy, but at least if we are clear and transparent and tell teachers and parents and students what the real expectations are in concrete, specific terms so that they have a chance to actually meet those standards, then maybe we could get a lot more students coming into college with the readiness that they actually need to be successful. Now, let me do a little bit of a thought experiment. Let's think this through a little bit further. Let's assume we actually did that. We actually had our assessments in the K-12 system actually aligned with genuine Michigan college readiness standards. Then when students get to the 11th grade and they take their state assessment and they find out where they are, they know whether A, they're college ready, or B, they're not. If they're college ready, why aren't they taking college courses? They don't have to go off to Ann Arbor to take college courses. They can take them in their high school now. Why aren't they doing that? Why isn't the senior year of high school, which everybody in this room knows is the biggest waste of time we've got in the education system, why aren't they taking college courses in their senior year of high school? If they're not college ready in that 11th grade examination, why aren't they taking their developmental remedial education then and there while they're still in high school and they still have a chance to fix it? Nobody is stopping us from doing this, except our ways of thinking about what high school is supposed to be and what college is supposed to be. You know, you didn't mention Lumen is based in Indiana, so when we talked about some of these ideas in Indiana, what's the first question? People say, that's a great idea, but what's it going to do to basketball? So those are the kind of challenges we're really dealing with. By the way, if we did that, you could finish your college degree, your bachelor's degree in 3 years, you'd finish your associate degree in 1 year, et cetera, et cetera. The benefits all just kind of cascade from thinking a little bit differently about how do we actually help all of these different people get what they need to be successful.
That's great. So let me weld together two questions on this card. Tim, maybe you can take the lead in starting to answer it. So kind of an elephant in the room question is the inflation, the cost of the degree. And so one of the questions from the audience is, how are the two-year schools doing battling that? But really behind that, I think, is a richer question, which is, if you thought about how businesses had to lean themselves out and do various things to address legacy practices that didn't work in the future, what would we say colleges and universities are doing to obsolete courses, programs, and staff to free up money? So kind of, can you start, and
sure,
we can weld those together?
Let me start with, I think, one of the things that all colleges and universities have done is really looked at what are the assumptions within the system. And I categorize them in four areas when I talk with our staff and other colleagues. You know, if you think about how colleges and universities were put together, we're on this continuum. We have moved, I contend, from a time-based system to a competency-based system, from a system that is predominantly place-based to one that is content-based, from one that is based on owning knowledge to one that is based on how do you have access to knowledge. And then lastly, from one that is a public good to one that's operating much more like a private entity to serve a public need. Well, unless you say that you're over here now on the right hand of these trend lines, you keep kind of monkeying around the edges, if you would, and you reduce costs, and we practice lean. We have our own lean consultants that work with business and industry, and they come into the organization. But I think we're really at an inflection point within our industry where you're talking about a restructuring of the educational experience for students. We still predominantly have one way through. And when you only have one way through, you end up treating people like they are cogs in a machine. And what we know is they're not. So we are doing multiple approaches. We're doing early and middle colleges with our high schools. We're working with universities in order to have joint programming. We have 9 university partners, many of them in the audience, who have served the Grand Traverse region. You can do everything through a 1-hour class through a doctorate degree without leaving, which reduces the average cost. It's like buying stock. Don't buy it all at once, buy it over a period of time. Community colleges are fortunate. They have a different business model, but our costs are going up. 72% of my costs are labor. Okay? And when you have a high labor organization, it's very difficult to reduce costs in a long-term permanent way without structurally changing how you deliver your services. And I think that's where we are. How do you use technology differently? How do you ask the student, the learner, to be more responsible for knowledge acquisition and use faculty and staff for critical thinking? How do you connect the dots? How do you breed creativity and innovation?
To the other two gentlemen, if you thought about the legacy and the future, what are some things that you forecast that are going to change that are not here today but could help the talent problem? And I'm thinking more of, you know, is there online courses? Right. Is there virtual classrooms? Is there...
Let me take a try at that. I think when we talk about access, whether a course is face-to-face, online, or hybrid, that's part of access. Central Michigan teaches 51 locations throughout this country, Mexico, Canada, and plus online. So that's part of access. But I think it really gets down as to how people learn and how our professionals, our faculty, present that information and learning to those students. Some students will learn fine online, others won't. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's a one fits all. Mm-hmm. It's about access, and to the extent that online courses provides more access to those learners out there who can benefit from it, I think we increase it. But I think there'll always be a need for face-to-face. There'll always be a need for a campus for people to go to.
Yeah.
And I think the access has to be making it more available. Again, educating students at a much younger level about the value and the importance of higher education and their families.
That confirms, George, what we think too, because they have to work with others later.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so they have to have the social experience along. Dwayne, any perspective on the past, future kind of transition we might see?
Well, it is an amazing world we're living in. I mean, the announcements are coming out literally weekly right now about things like MIT. It was mentioned, and Andre mentioned in the last panel about MITx and Harvard joining that, getting a lot of publicity. Coursera, which is a new startup involving the people who started that Stanford artificial intelligence course that had, I think, what was that, 160,000 students, of which about 25 or 26,000 actually completed the course. And now people are beginning to figure out, how do we actually recognize that learning so that people might even get credit for it, might even actually be able to apply it to a degree. We know that people learn in a whole lot of different ways, and a lot of young people now get, you know, they actually expect to learn online. They are online a lot of their life anyway. Their social networks are increasingly online. So it's not as quite a threat to them as perhaps it is to others. But granted, what learning itself is never easy. Learning, the act of learning, of mastering a new skill, of learning something deep, always takes hard work. So that's never going to go away. And figuring out how to help all kinds of different people to have that experience where they can actually learn and master something, that's the real value of education. So I think we're in a world where we're seeing what a lot of us in education have traditionally seen as sort of the value of the institutions in particular, in terms of course content, in terms of knowledge, sort of these repositories of knowledge, that is breaking down. The knowledge is starting to be everywhere. And it's more and more likely that people will just go and be able to access very, very high quality courses. These are not just, you know, online videos. We're talking about very well designed instructional materials. Mm. But what they will need is that ability to work with professionals in the learning process, to synthesize that with what they already know and incorporate it in what they can already do. And people who are really good at that and institutions that are really good at that are going to thrive in this environment. The ones that define themselves in terms of course content, in my opinion, are going to have a very, very difficult time of it.
Some work being done by our governor to fix, you know, high schools that are falling behind involves this kind of artificial line in which somebody graduates and goes on, even though they may not have mastered the material.
Right.
What's your sense of whether our drive for talent is having a corresponding kind of negative effect to bring those who might mature later, that have trouble in various settings,
right,
but their future sits there? There's lots of famous stories of people who didn't
Absolutely.
Do so well as they were younger and they blossomed later.
Well, if I can, that this is what we're talking about, all of these, this rich panoply of individuals who all learn in different ways and all have different needs at different stages of their life. But we tend not to think about education that way. Even though we all experience it that way, we don't think about the systems that way. We think about a very rigid sort of progression through a system in a very time-based way. We don't actually have to do it that way. The competency-based approaches already exist. Western Governors University, for example, is a well-established institution which any state can now add to their array of offerings. Is it the right answer for everybody? Of course not. But is it the right answer for certain adults who have certain set of skills and need an ability to come back and quickly master fields in areas like business or nursing or teacher education so that they can get back into the workforce quickly? A competency-based approach like that can make a whole lot of sense for somebody like that. And making that option available to them also makes a lot of sense. So we should never close the door on anybody. Everybody should have that shot to always come back. I mean, newsflash, none of us are ever done with education anymore. The idea you get inoculated when you're 22 years old and you're set for life, everybody knows that's not the way it works. We're always going to be coming back to education, and everybody will. It's all about constantly upgrading your skills. One more thing on this. You know, for 20, 30 years, I've been talking about the shift from low-skill occupations to high-skill occupations. And, of course, that's not what's happening now. All occupations are becoming higher-skill occupations. It doesn't matter what you do. The skill levels keep going up. You know, we all know this. If we don't keep current, what happens? We fall behind, and before long, we've got a performance issue.
George, this, the politics of this to our audience isn't where I'm coming, but when Dwayne said the door shouldn't be closed, what's your sense of the immigration policies in this regard? Are they limiting the talent that we're allowing into the system, or is it just right, or should it be a leaner, a harsher door to get through?
Immigration policies in this country?
Yeah, yes, to let students come into our system and graduate and go into our workforce.
Hmm.
This is the last question, by the way. So.
Well, thank you for that, Jim. There's such a need for talent, and let's talk about Michigan, across the country, but in this state, to the extent that we can figure out legislatively how to get talented students into our universities and get them educated and trained and ready to help Michigan move forward. I'm going to defer to the legislature and legislative policies, but I, within the limits of the law, I think we should give everybody opportunity and look and seek talent wherever it lies.
Well, and I want to thank you for that answer, because as a CEO and traveling the world, just coming back from Malaysia, seeing young people that are working on Steelcase employees working on projects, it all melds together. Mm-hmm. And you basically realize that if we have talent, Michigan and Steelcase will be strong. There's not a advantage to how you secularize that. So, gentlemen, thank you for your candor and your time, and we appreciate all you do to help us raise the talent level in Michigan.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.